for the last few weeks, you'll give me here about a few minutes here this morning. How many are ready to hear the Word of God? The last few weeks, I've been preaching from Joshua 24:15. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And that word was directed to the leadership of the home, whether it be the husband or the single mother, or even a house where the woman is a spiritual voice, whatever the case may be. It's important that someone set the standard in the house that we will serve the Lord. Everybody say that with me. We will serve the Lord. It's important. Today, to say we will serve the Lord, it's actually what you're doing is you're setting a purpose in the house. You're setting a principle, a standard. It's setting the course, a direction that the house or the home will pursue. What a powerful statement when you think about that. We will serve the Lord. It's a powerful statement. It's beautiful. It's not to be taken lightly. And there's no greater thing to see than you see, when you see a family coming to the house of God. The father, the mother, the kids right behind them, when you see them coming out the car. I love that. As a pastor, I love it. Because when you see a car pull up to the house of God and you see the dad come out and the wife, and they're getting the kids out the car and they're coming into church, it's more than just people coming to church. It's a beautiful thing. It's a generation. Are you hearing me? It's a generational thing. It's a standard. It's the current generation leading the up and coming generation into the house of God. It's the way it should be. You know, I grew up like that. I grew up where you just went to church. You know what I mean? You went to church on Sundays. There was no matter of fact, on Sundays, if you saw somebody not going to church, that was weird. Like, I don't go to church. There was a time. Hello? There was a time. I remember I'm an 80s kid. Born in 74, I'm an 80. There was a time when at school, you know, everybody, you just knew everybody went to church on Sunday. And when somebody just says, church, I don't go to church. What? You don't go to church? You don't. It was normal that everybody went to church. It didn't matter if you went to the Catholic church, the Baptist church. We didn't know doctrine when we were kids. We just knew church. Sunday, church. Are y'all with me? And so there was a time when that was normal. Now, it's become, you know, the bad thing to do. But that's why it's so important, now more than ever, that there be a voice that stands up and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
And so, I thought about that statement, and as I thought about it, because I went through these passages and God began to deal with me concerning the power of the will, to say we will serve the Lord. A lot of times we look at that word as a will, is a word of saying this is what we're going to do. We will. This is what we're doing. And so to stand up and declare we will is a statement of demand, of purpose. And so when we stand up and declare we will, we can do that all we want. But before there is a we will, there has to be an I will declare. I thought about that. Because we will is corporate. We will is corporate. I talk about the men or the women saying we will. You're corporately saying this is what we will do as a home. We will serve the Lord. We will go to church. We will worship. That's corporate declaration. But before there is a corporate declaration, there must be a personal sanctification. There needs to be a personal declaration. I always precedes the we. Are y'all following me? Because I'm gonna do a little teaching this morning. I want you to follow me. We doesn't have power until there is an I. We has, matter of fact, we has very little power when there is no I. If you're a man, if you're a leader of your home, if you're the husband, and you stand up and say, we will serve the Lord. Now, y'all go to church. I'm going to sit here and watch TV and the football. Y'all go, because we're a Christian home. Now, y'all go to church. How foolish is that for someone to declare who we are, yet not participate in the action of that they're decorating for the home? There's tons of it. There's a lot of homes like that. And so, before there's a we, for the we to have power, there has to be an I. Before you say we will, you have to say I will. It's personal. Your relationship with God was personal. Before you say we will serve the Lord, you have to stand up and declare, I will serve the Lord. I will go to God's house. I will worship. I will be faithful. I will be free. I will serve. And so today I'm starting a new series called I Will. Because there needs to be some personal declarations over our own lives before we can impose those same declarations onto the people we're connected to. We have to start taking responsibility for our own actions and our decisions. And so God has been dealing with me about the will of man. The will of man. We are the, like I told you, there are three levels of creation. The inanimate, and man. Three levels. The inanimate level creation is the things that like the trees, the rocks, the grass. Those are inanimate things. Those are things that they don't have, they don't speak, they don't have minds, they don't have thoughts. They're just inanimate. They're it's wood, it's steel, it's inanimate. They're just there. This thing is never gonna get up and walk out of this church. If it does, we got a problem. This pulpit is not gonna grow legs and walk out. You know what I mean? That chair is not just when you sit on it, it's gonna say, hey, you're heavy. You know, if it ever talks to you, you got a problem. You know what I'm talking about? That chair is not supposed to, it's inanimate. It doesn't have any breath, air in it. So that is controlled by its creator. I can take this pole and put it wherever I want. You can move that chair. It's not going to have a decision in what it does because it has somebody who carries it. That's an inanimate level of creation. In other words, that has no will. There's the inanimate level, that's the inanimate, and then there's the inanimate level. The inanimate level are things like birds and dogs. They're still a form of creation higher than the inanimate, but yet they really don't have a will because God said in the beginning that we have authority over the fish in the air and the birds of the air and the fish of the sea and the animals and everything that creep in. We control that. We can get a dog and chain him up. We can get a bird and put it in a cage. We can get an elephant and put it in a zoo and make it dance, and we can teach it tricks and put it in a circus and do all that. Why? Because we are ultimately a higher level of creation. They really don't have a will. A dog can run, it can think, it can move. An animal can hunt and do all these things and make these types of decisions. But at the end of the day, we are higher than, so it really doesn't have a will per se. Are y'all with me? But it can breathe, it can do it. So we are the only level of creation, but God, when God created man and woman, we are the only part of creation that God says, choose this day who you will serve. We can willfully serve God, or we can willfully not serve God. We can willfully say, you are my God, or we can walk away and say, I don't believe in you. We see it all over our world, right? There are people who serve God, people who don't. That's the tough thing about man. In the Bible, you will find the statement, I will, 3,780 times. Let me say that again. You will find the statement, I will, 3,780 times. 3,780 times somebody declared, I will. 3,780 times somebody made a decision. 3,780 times in the Bible. Now, if something's written 3,780 times in a book with only 66 books, you know that's an important statement. Are y'all with me? That's an important declaration. And so what is our will? What is the will of man? What does it consist of? How do you define man's will? Our will is a part of our soul. We are a triune being, spirit, soul, and body. It's within the soul that we have that contains the will. The will is the ability to make decisions. The will is the will is within the soul, and that's the ability to make decisions. So you have your own will. That's why when your soul isn't right, and your soul contains your will, that's why when your soul isn't right, when it's bothered, when it's destroyed, when it's disturbed, when you have a soul problem, you make bad decisions. Why? Because you can't balance your will. A young lady who's damaged in the soul will make horrible decisions. A young man who's damaged will make horrible decisions. As a Christian, as a believer, that's why we make our decisions based on our faith in God. Because your faith is inside what? You're sowing. You contain your mind, your thoughts, your will, all of these things. And so, as a Christian, we make our decisions based on our faith, on what we believe. Everybody say, I believe.
I believe.
So, what you believe. Another word for faith is confidence. When you have faith in God, you have what? Confidence in God, right? That's why the Bible says in John chapter 5, now this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He will hear it. We have what? Everybody say confidence. So faith is the same word as confidence. But our problem isn't our confidence in God. Our problem is having confidence in ourselves. That's why there has to be an I will. That's why you have to take it personal. Are y'all with me? So, why is self-confidence important? Because confidence in ourselves is where we get self-will from. I'm going to teach this thing, y'all. Follow me. Self-will. Self-will is important. And confidence in ourselves is where we get self-will from. And I know I'm getting ahead of myself, but let me teach this a little. We use the root word will in so many phrases and applications. Willful, being willful, willfulness, goodwill. Everybody know what goodwill is, right? Willpower, the sheer force of will. You'll find the word will in all these phrases and declarations. According to the dictionary, will, or the word will, has many definitions. It is used to imply the future. I will go to the store. That the word will. It's also defined as to wish or to desire or like go where you will. That's where you desire. Look at that statement. Go where you will. That's like a desire. The definition, however, that I'm mostly intrigued with is this notion. It is the facility of consciousness, and especially the deliberate action, the power of control the mind has over its own action, the freedom of will. That's what I like, that definition right there. When you have control over your own actions, that's your will, what I will to do. That's the definition. The power of choosing one's own action, to have a strong or weak will. You know, there are people who are strong-willed. There are people who are weak-willed. People who are strong-willed, you can't make them do anything. You can't make them do anything. Some of you know your spouse. They're strong-willed. So I can't. When they make them, I can't make them. Some of you have your spouse that have weak-willed. You know, oh, she'll go. I just got to tell her. She'll go. She said no, but she'll go. She's weak-willed. She'll give in. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Right? So strong-willed and weak-willed. That's why the will is important. So another definition, the act or process of using or asserting one's choice, the will. You see, the will is a muscle. It is a muscle. We nurture it. It's developed. All right, let me go a little deeper. A direct correlation with the will is the belief that what you think or do in life matters. Everybody say that with me. What I think and what I do matters. It matters. That's the power of you up. This takes us back to the work of confidence. Confidence is primarily developed in two areas of our life. Where do you get confidence from? Why is confidence so? I'm gonna show you why confidence is so important to you. Because remember, I told you confidence is almost the same word as faith. It's important you have, in order to have strong faith, you have to have strong confidence. Because having strong faith is saying, I am confident that God will do this, right? But if you have no confidence in yourself, you'll never say, I will do this. You'll never say, I will, because you go, well, if I say I will, I don't know if I can really do it. I've had a lot of people say, I'll go to church. I will be at church this Sunday. And they ain't there. They lied to me. What happened? Somewhere between the I will and that Sunday morning, something happened that detoured them. But there are people, when they say, I will be there, they're there. No matter come hell or high water, they're going to be there. Why? Because they have confidence in their own word that they just gave you. Hello? And so when you're strong, well, that's why I haven't got. So there are two things that build confidence, two things that give people confidence. Watch this. The first is experiencing love. Ooh, I can tie that to God real quick. That's why it's easy to have confidence in your God. You know why it's easy to have confidence or what? What's another word for confidence? Faith. Oh, y'all with me? Another word for confidence is what?
Faith.
Why is it easy to have faith or confidence in God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Why is it easy to have faith or confidence in God? Because you know, like you know, like you know, that Jesus loves me. Are y'all with me? God loves me. Do you know God loves you? Do you know that? How many know it? You wouldn't be at church this morning if you didn't know it. I know God loves me. Why? Because he sent his son Jesus to die for my sin. Why? Because he forgives me of my sin. I know. No, can't nobody convince me that God don't love me, right? What is you knowing that God loves you, but builds your confidence in God? See, if you feel loved and accepted, you naturally see yourself whole and healthy, and then you exude confidence about life, about where you are. Why? Because there's someone who loves me. I experienced this when I met my wife, and we fell in love. I was single for 38 years. When I met my wife and we fell in love, all of a sudden I had this new level of self-confidence. Have you ever seen a 450-pound confident man?
Yep.
Oh, y'all didn't know I used to be 100 pounds. Show you the picture later. I was a big old confident man. Now, a lot of people thought I was confident already because I was a preacher. I'd get up and preach. And pass. Man, I walked around confident. I looked confident, but I really wasn't that confident. I had a lot of insecurities. But all of a sudden, when I met someone who said, I will love you, that built my confidence. Have you ever really felt loved by someone? Are y'all with me? Come on, this is a good point for your husband. Your husband put your arm around your wife and be like, my baby gives me confidence. This is a good point. Just letting you know. Get some brownie points. She may buy you a barbecue sandwich after church, I'm just saying. All of a sudden, I had this confidence because I could walk around and I knew someone loved me. She didn't even have to be with me. And I walked around feeling confident because somewhere over there in Grand Prairie, Texas, someone loved all that I was.
Yeah.
I get chills just thinking about it. And that confidence grew more when we got married. Now watch. I'll never forget how I felt the day after I got married and I was walking out that hotel room on after my honeymoon. Oh, y'all ain't with me. 38 years! I walked out strutting, son. Yeah, there y'all. Why? I'm not talking about what you're thinking about. But when I walked out confident because I said, you see her? She loved me. Why? Because she said, we went to the altar last night and she said, I will. Or I do. Do you marry him? I sure do. I felt like I was the man. Why? Because no matter where I went, I was confident of one thing, that I knew that there was someone out there that loved me. Are y'all with me this morning? Because she married me. So see, no one made her marry me. I hope right there. No one made her marry me. She married me because she looked at me and said, I will marry him. That built confidence in me. That gave me the confidence to declare things in my life that I had never declared before. That gave me the confidence to say things in my life I had never said before. That gave me the confidence to stand before things in my life that I never stood before. That gave me the confidence to say, I will. It gave me the confidence to stand in certain areas. Okay, the second way that self-confidence is built is through success. It's like the little boy who learns how to ride a bike, and all of a sudden he gets on the bike and he's holding the handlebars and he's trying to balance and he's pedaling and he's falling down. And all of a sudden, once he starts pedaling and once he begins to stay up, that little boy, he's going, look, daddy, look at me, mom, look, I got it. All of a sudden he has his confidence, and now he went from just making it from one block to the other. Now he wants to build a ramp and jump around. Yeah, all this confidence, I want to go do this. Why? this success, once you have experienced success at something, you become more confident and willing to try having success in other areas. You find it now that you have confidence, and confidence produces willpower. Am I teaching too much? Y'all following me? Confidence produces willpower. I'm laying down the foundation. Willpower comes from the desire to do something. When you have willpower, remember, we're talking about will, the confidence. You cannot have willpower without confidence. Once somebody builds confidence, once you build confidence, then you can have the power of will to do something. A person who is not confident don't want to do anything. They walk around, no, I don't know. You want to go, I don't think I can make it. You want to go, I don't know if I can. They don't have no willpower. But when you have somebody who's real confident, you say, hey, you want to go? Yeah, man, let's do it. I've never done it before, but I'll try it. Why? Because they have the willpower to try it. Think about it like this. Desire. Willpower is the desire. Desire is the fuel that propels your will. When you have a desire to be something. Desire is when you want something, right? Because if you want something bad enough, it's much easier to put in the work to get it. So people talk about willpower a lot when it comes to losing weight. If you have a desire to be healthy and you're strong enough, if you want it bad enough, and you have good motivation, which is desire, it's easier to delay self-gratification for the moment and get up and go to the gym and make healthy choices. Why? Because I have the willpower to delay that gratification now. I want to eat that burger now. I want to eat that cookie now. But I'm going to delay that so I can eat it later and have the willpower to say no so I can get to my goal, to where I want to be. Then I can enjoy that later, but I have to have the willpower to go from there to here. The willpower. It's the power of will. So here's the question. The question is, do you really want it bad enough? Do you really want it bad enough? Wanting something gives you the will to succeed, but will or faith without action is dead. So the question is, how bad do you want it? How bad do you want God in your life? How bad do you want God to bless you? How bad do you want God to move in your family? How bad do you want God to bless your children? How bad do you want God to restore your life? How bad do you want it? Do you want it bad enough to say, I will? Are y'all with me? I got saved. Y'all already know. Y'all, the guys were making fun of me the other day at the camp. But I got saved. Y'all remember the day I got saved? What? June 23rd, 1991. When I got saved on June 23rd, 1991, remember it. When I got saved on that day, I made a declaration in my life, I will serve the Lord. It was easy. I was 18 years old. It was easy. It was easy for me to go home and finish that quarterback of weed that I had hidden behind that old television set. Oh, I'm telling y'all the truth this morning now. But I said, when I got my heart to the Lord, I said, I will serve the Lord. So I grabbed that bag and I threw it down the toilet. Because I will serve the Lord. I will serve the Lord. So what I did, I cut off all my old friends that I knew would pull me back because I will serve the Lord. So I got away from them. I will serve the Lord. So I got up every time the church doors were open, I was going to church. Why? Because I made a declaration I will serve the Lord. Are y'all with me? It was a declaration because I wanted God more than I wanted anything. I fell in love with him. And when I found out he loved me, I got God. I said, he loves me. And so I built this confidence and I said, I will serve the Lord. Are y'all following me? See how this is connected here? And then when I started serving God, I found out that he gave me gifts and talents. I didn't know I had them when I'm, you see, there's something about being in the world. The Satan won't reveal to you the gifts and talents God has put in you. He kept me stoned and high. He kept me partying, focused on foolish things. I never knew I had a gift to preach or speak. I never knew I had a gift for music. I never knew I had these gifts. Why? Because Satan kept me so high on worldly, fleshly things that I didn't have the confidence or the willpower to go out and explore and pick up a microphone and open my mouth. And if I didn't have the willpower, I didn't have the confidence to do it. But when I came to Jesus, and God broke every every demonic bind that had on my life. I began to pick up things and gifts that I realized, wow, not only does God love me, but he's given me the ability to do these things. Not only has given me ability, but now I'm experiencing success in these areas. Praise the Lord. I will. Then I begin to make declaration. I will be in the ministry. Yeah, God, I'll go there. Yeah, I will preach. Yeah, I will do this for God. Why? Because I began to experience these things. And so a decision to declare I will means what happened? And in the middle of I will, here's what I want you to catch too. I will is not just a declaration of something you will do, but it's a declaration of something you will not do. Because you cannot say to God, I will, and not at the same time give up yourself. You can't say, I will serve the Lord and still serve the world at the same time. Are you with me? You have to give up that to take this. You can't say, I will go to God's house and sleep in on Sunday mornings and not go to church. Why? Because that's when we go to God's house. So I'm giving up my self-will, my self-desires to follow what I decided that I would do for him. Because why? Because I love him. Everybody shout, I will. There has to be a will. Now watch. I will means that you give up yourself. You give up. To say I will to God means that you give up your own will. I want you to hear me. Many times I will, when you say I will to God, you're actually saying no to your own will. Because sometimes you don't want to do God's will. Sometimes it feels better to do your own will sometimes, right? No, it feels better to do. So when you say to God, I will, you're actually saying no to your own will. You're giving up your will, you're giving up your pleasure, and you're giving up your own plan. Jesus, this thing's getting harder and harder. Now watch. You must give up anything and everything that stands between you and God. You have to will to do God's will. You have to will to do God's will. I will is a place of decision. It's a place of confidence that comes from the desire to praise God and to please God. You will never understand nor experience the fullness of God's Spirit until you've given up your total will, your total family, and your total desires. I will. Everybody shout, I will. Let me tell you the truth this morning. Sometimes it doesn't matter how much you know the Word of God, or how much you go to church, or how much you hear pastor preach, or how much you hear a good message or hear worship. When it comes down to it, you've got to want to change. You got to will it. You got to will it. Sometimes, now watch this, this is going to blow your mind, but sometimes faith is not enough. Listen when I tell you this. Faith, your faith in God isn't enough. It's not what's going to change you. What do you mean, God? I thought we needed faith. Yeah, you need faith. But you can't just have faith in itself. Faith in itself is not enough. Why? Because the Bible says faith without action is dead. What action? The action of your will. Self-action. Peter came to the edge of the boat. Peter said, call me. Jesus said, come. You have faith? You have faith on Jesus? Yeah. Come. Step out that boat, Peter. Let me see action to your faith. So Peter had, in his mind, he said, I will believe. I will go to Jesus. I will take this step. Do you see that? Faith without action is dead. It takes more than faith to change. More than faith to serve God. More than faith to be there. You have to have faith with the power of your will to make a move. I've been telling you the last few weeks, if you'll move, he'll move. Y'all with me? You can have faith all you want, but while you're having faith, there has to be a point where sheer force of your will kicks in. There has to come a point where you say, I will not go back. I remember the day I made that decision while I was serving God. I remember. I gave my life to the Lord and I went back to school and I saw something change in me. Something changed. I remember I was in North Shore High School. We were in gym class. I think we were in the locker room actually, and we're getting ready for gym class, or we had to enter gym, and I was looking around and I had changed inside. I hadn't told nobody yet. I looked and everybody was, hey, talking about this and that, and I smiled. It was Monday morning. Everybody's talking about what they did for the weekend. I didn't go to the parties. I didn't do nothing. I went to church. I gave my heart to the Lord. And I'm sitting there, everybody's talking about, yeah, we're doing this, man. We're at this house party, this house. And I'm sitting there, I'm smiling and putting on the t-shirt. Oh, yeah. I'm smiling, but it's a half smile, because inside, that talk would please me. It didn't please me no more. Now I felt like crying, because I was still full of the presence of God from the night before. They were still feeling the weed. I was still feeling the Holy Ghost. And they were talking about how good the party was. And I so bad wanted to say, well, let me tell you how good church was. And I remember sitting there. And that day I looked and I said, I'm not going back to this. I had a choice. I could have gotten there and said, oh, yeah, I forgot about that experience I had the day before. But I looked that day, I looked and I said, I will not. I will serve the Lord. I don't want that no more. Something happened in me. I will serve God. And I've been doing it ever since for over 25 years. Are you hearing me? When it looks like your prayers are not being answered, dig deep inside and pray. I will believe. That's the power of our will. When the encouragement of your faith isn't there, you have to stand up and say, I will not give up. When people give up on you and you have to look inside of yourself and say, I will keep moving forward. When you're tired and you don't feel like serving, and you know that God has been good to you, and you go anyway and say, I will serve the Lord. I will. Why? Because he's been good. There's no other story more powerful of the will, the sheer will, than the story of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15, when he was at the lowest moment of his life. I love this passage. There he was feeding the pigs. Y'all remember the prodigal son, right? There he was feeding the pigs, and he didn't hear, and he was there discouraged. He was lonely. And he didn't hear a voice from heaven. A voice from heaven didn't. God didn't speak to him and say, my son, get up from thy pig pen and go to thy father's house, and there you will find forgiveness. No, he didn't hear none. He didn't even feel the Holy Ghost. Matter of fact, he felt discouraged. He felt defeated. He felt down. He didn't feel any of that. He didn't walk into a church and hear preaching that spoke to him. It wasn't. He didn't hear singing and worship. He had done all those things before. But when he was at the lowest moment in his life, he remembered in the deep soul of his mind and in his will, he remembered the faithfulness of his father. There he was, the prodigal son. And he started to remember. The Bible says that he was there feeding the pigs, and he wanted so bad to eat the pig food because he was starving. I can imagine him reaching in there, grabbing a corn husk. And he looks at it and it smells, it stinks spoiled. And he has the desire, he's so hungry, and he threw it down. The Bible says, he said, how many of my father's servants have food to spare? And here I am, feeding these pigs. The Bible says, and he came to himself. Have you ever thought about that? The longest journey you can ever make is the journey of coming to yourself. He came to himself. That means something clicked in his mind. Boom. He was discouraged. He was down. He was far. In his mind, he was far from home. But he came to himself and he said, wait a minute. What am I doing here? What brought me this far from God? How did I get this far from God that I'm sitting in the filth of a pit stop? How did I get here? At one time, I was at my father's house. I had a ring that belonged. I had a coat. I was a prince. I had servants. But look at me now. Look where sin has brought me. I'll tell you what, that day he realized sin will take you further than you want to go and charge you more than you want to pay and keep you longer than you want to stay. When you find yourself in the middle of a place, like in the pigspen, and that day, I love what he said next. Watch this. The Bible says he came to himself. Now watch. Luke 15:17, it says, and when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough to spare and I perish with hunger? Now watch verse 18. Watch what he says. He didn't say, well, you know, I think I might go to church this Sunday. You know, I think I might do this. No, verse 18, he said, I will arise and go to my father. He didn't lean on anything else but his will. He leaned on what he knew about his father. Because he knew if he went to his father would accept him. His father would forgive him. So he said, I will go, I will arise and go. Woo! That same word, arise, the Bible says that when a woman came and was caught in adultery, she was caught in the act, she was down, the people were there to stone her. And Jesus said, that he who has no sin cast the first stone. And everybody was going to stone her, drop their stone, because they were all at sin in their life. They walked away. Then he walked up to her and said, woman, where are thy accusers? She looked up and she said, they're gone. What did he say next? What did he tell her next? He didn't tell her, now watch, this is where, he didn't tell her, okay, now what you're going to do now, since you got caught in adultery, you're going to go through a 2-year disciplinary program. I'm going to discipline you for 2 years. You're going to sit down. Then I'm going to talk to you. You're going to go through counseling. No. See, religious people, what did he say that? He said, woman, get up, arise, go, and sin no more. Arise, go, and sin no more. The most powerful statement you can make in your life is to get up and say, I will arise and go to my father. When he did that, he was restored back to his place as a son in his father's house. See, one I will could bring you back into the right place with God. Religion says you gotta light 10 candles, say 5 Hail Marys and 3 Hallelujahs and 10 Guadalupes. Jesus said, just say I will and come back home, honey. Just say I will and get back in my presence. Just get up from where you are. Come to the cross, because I'll be right here waiting for you. We have a Father who all he wants you to say is, I will love you, Jesus. I will serve you. I will give. I will go and I will be your son. I will. When was the last time you stood up and said, I will? And so me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I will. I think I'm going to talk about this one tonight in Psalms chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. David makes one of the most decisive prayers of I will that I've ever heard. He says this in Psalms chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. He says, give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Give heed to the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For to you I will pray. My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord, and in the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up, my God. And he says this, for you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor shall evil dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate the workers of iniquity. You shall destroy those who speak falsehood. The Lord harbors and the bloodthirsty, deceitful man. It says, but as for me, I will come into your house. I
in fear of you. I will worship toward your holy temple.
There has to be a declaration of I will in your life. Can I tell you, every father and mother, your children will not say I will until you say I will. Don't declare we will until you declare I will. You can't say we will do something unless you haven't done it yourself. Amen. Your family is falling. You have to declare I will. I will. I will. And then you can declare we will. Come on this morning. Will you stand up with me, church? Come on. I'm ending right there. The next several weeks, we're going to talk about more about this, the I will, because there's a lot of things that we have to declare over our lives, that you have to declare over your life, because God is not going to move until you move. You have to say, I will, I will, I will. What a powerful statement. What a powerful thing to declare what you will do. To declare it not just with a hope of expectation. I will is not a hope of expectation. It's a position of decision. I will. You're not saying I will. I will serve the Lord, but I hope everything turns out all right. You're not saying I will worship if I feel good that day. You're not saying that. I will is not a hope of expectation. It's a place of decision. I will. I will. I will. Some of you say, if I ask you, are you going to get up and go to work in the morning? You say, oh yeah, I will. Why? Because I have to. No working, no money, right? No, I don't work, I don't get paid. Now I'm asking, are you going to come worship with us this morning, tonight? Well, I don't know, because, you know, if the rain and then I go, you need to go to sleep, and then the way my bank account works is that I got to transfer. But guess what? No worship, no blessing. No Jesus, no life. Hello? Hello? I will. My God, there's a lot of decision making that has to happen in our life. You want God to bless you? You want things to get better? Make some decisions. I will serve the Lord. I will be faithful. I will love Him no matter what. I will worship, I will praise Him. I will lift my voice and declare. I love Psalm 103. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. I will. We have to will to do His will. Come on, lift your hands this morning if you receive that. Father, I declare this morning that as we are making decisions of what we will do, because of who you are. Lord, we've done a lot in our life that has brought us, that has taken us far from you. We've all done a lot in our life that has separated us from you. We've all done a lot of things in our life that we regret. We've all done a lot of things in our life that we need your mercy and grace over our lives for. We need you to forgive us, and you've been faithful to do it. Because we serve a faithful God, but today we are making declarations of what we will do for you. I will serve you. I will worship you. I will never give up. I will be faithful. You will be my God, and I will be your child. I will be your son. I will be your daughter. I will, because you willed. You willed your son. When you told Jesus, when you go on the cross, He said, I will. And now I can stand here forgiven because He said, I will. And so today we declare, we will, I will in the name of Jesus. I will be healed. I will be delivered. I will be set free. I will go where you want me to go, Lord. I will do what you want me to do. I will. In the name of Jesus. Come on. Some of you need to make some declarations of I will in your life. Some of you need to make declarations even over your spouse. I will love you. I will love you. I will build you. I will encourage
you. You see, there's a lot of things we can say, but it has to, there are a lot of things we can want to do, but it has to be a power of your will. You got a will to do it. You got a will to do it. I know it gets tough. I know it gets hard sometimes. I know I've been doing this damn serving the Lord for over 20 years. I know it's hard to be a Christian sometimes. It's hard to come to church sometimes. It's hard to serve. But you get to the point where you say, I will not go back. I will serve him because he's been too good for me. I will be faithful. So Father, I pray for a spirit of decision in this place, a spirit of faith, a spirit of confidence, that they know that they'll have confidence because they know that you love them. In the name of Jesus, we declare it today. I declare your presence, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. How many receive that, church? Come on. You receive that this morning? Ooh, what a powerful thing, the will of man. What a powerful thing you have. God has given each of us a gift of the will. You're here because you want to be here. My pastor mama didn't make you come here. God didn't make you. You're here because you want to be here, honey. You're here. You're standing right here because you will to be here. And I'm telling you right now, that's a gift of God. God gave you the gift. And right now, God's looking at you and he's pleased that you chose to walk into his house this morning. He's pleased. Why? Because you did it out of your will. And see, I'm tired. I won't go to church because religion tells me I have to go. I go to church because my relationship with Jesus compels me to go. Hello? I go home every day because I love my wife. I want to go home. You know what I mean? I want to go. I can't wait to see her. I come to God's house because he is my father and I love him. Hello? Because it's my will to do his will. Come on, church. I want to invite you this morning to continue the worship experience. We're going to come here. We're going to start right at 6 and we're just going to start worshiping. We're just going to start praising God. I invite you to come and experience that, all right? Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. We bless you in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for the power of will and choice that we choose to worship you. We thank you in the name of Jesus. We pray. Amen. Now, I want everybody to say this with me. Say, I will serve the Lord. I will be here tonight. And say it one more thing. I will go buy me a barbecue sandwich. Praise the Lord. God bless you.